portfolio of technologies, core connectivity portfolio and computing portfolio. And we scale up and down and across different segments to address the need that's there in the IoT space. Because as I said, it's about diversity, and every IoT device, the requirements are different. But there are certain common elements, and those common elements are fortunately very close to what we have seen or the issues that we have resolved in the mobile space. So how many of you come from mobile space or Android development and trying to go into the IoT space? So we are just like you. We come from the same space and we feel that there is a lot of leverage. That's where we are going. So speaking of which, we talked about the what of IoT. The second part is the who of IoT. Who's going to bring this revolution? Who are the key stakeholders? You know, since it is so diverse and it is so scalable, we don't believe that one company or, you know, the big companies, only the few big companies are going to be part of this revolution. In fact, Gartner has predicted that by 2018, 50% of the IoT solutions will be from startups less than 3 years old. And what does that mean for all of us? It's very important to know that there are developers such as yourself who are going from one space, which is the Android development or mobile development or software only development, to this hardware plus software, this system development, which is IoT. System development is one of the key requirements or a skill requirement for IoT. So it's important to know that. But having said that, what we have also noticed is that 75% of the IoT developers, they have less than 2 years of experience. And as I said, that there is this whole transition of developers going from software to system or from Android or mobile to IoT space. But also there is a whole new generation of engineers that is coming and getting behind this addressing this IoT space.
Oh, and question, why are they moving from Android over to IoT?
Anybody would like, I saw a lot of hands up, why are you moving? Or I don't know if it's like a move, but rather in addition to Android, there's something in addition.
That's one of the thing is really which you do the IoT stuff, which makes it really easy to actually IoT or Android device. From Qualcomm's point of view, they are making fine that they were very intelligent in the IoT stuff. But if you don't want that, then you can use your cell phone by choosing the IoT for that.
So, in my opinion or in our opinion, we feel there are two reasons to it. One, the mobile space itself is saturating or the growth is becoming steady. It's a mature industry. Second, there is a lot of leverage. So the technologies or the skill set that Android developers have earned, you know, while working on it, they are leverageable in this new space. So that's, in my opinion, the reason that there is a shift. So coming back to Qualcomm's role in this innovation, you guys have heard about Kickstarters and tech shops and maker fairs. There is a huge trend where there is lot more number of maker fairs coming up. There are, I think, $1.33 billion invested across 73 different innovations from Kickstarter. So, you know, huge numbers. There is a lot of financial resources that are becoming available to make this maker innovation into commercial success, but there is also the technologies that are becoming available. And we have a huge R&D investment and portfolio of technologies that come out of that R&D investment, which we believe we can use to help these developers bring their maker innovation to commercial success or commercial marketplace. And in turn, we believe that some of these innovation or the commercial marketplace success will feed into our R&D focus. So it's going to be a model where our investment into R&D will help your innovation and your success into market will feed back into our R&D. And that's why we are here today and trying to bring some technologies from Qualcomm to you. So, you know, we talked about the what and the who. Now the question is how. So how do we go about developing for IoT, right? And I've been working on the DragonBoard team for the past 5 years now. I've talked to many developers in this time and come across various challenges that these developers have faced when they start this IoT development. So the first one that I've heard a lot is no clear path to commercialization. What does that mean? So while there are many technologies and technology platforms that are becoming available through this maker fairs and tech shops and all these resources that are becoming available to us, these development resources don't necessarily always turn into commercialization resources. I was talking to a gentleman here right before I started my presentation, and he was talking about the same thing, and he does something where he helps the startups bring their innovation to retail marketplace, which is a very important part of commercialization success. So what I've heard from some of the developers is when they start working on platforms like Raspberry Pi or Arduino, and there are many others, when they are done with their development and prototyping, they hit a wall. They can't translate that development work. When they start doing the actual commercial product development, they either run into issue of the code not being optimized for the commercial product. It's too big. It's not relevant. It's not done using the technologies that you use for doing the commercial development. Or they run into the hardware issue where there is limitation on the hardware form factor, that the modules are being available, and so you can't convert that development into commercialization. So that's one of the challenges that I have heard about. The other one I have heard about is a singular scalable IoT ecosystem. So which is the most successful consumer electronics device today? It's the mobile phone. And the ecosystem behind it is huge. And developers, IoT developers, want to leverage that ecosystem, and there is lack of the tools that are based on these mobile ecosystem, and that's where Snapdragon processors or Qualcomm's technologies come into play for IoT. So besides mobile ecosystem being the largest, there is also a very close tie to the technology. So I'll give you some examples. Most of the IoT applications need smaller device. They need a very good connectivity, and they need a good amount of computing as some of these applications evolve. And we, as a company, have put all of these technologies in the mobile phone. For a number of years, we have been iterating and investing a lot of money to work around those same constraints. So we feel the requirements are the same, so the solution will translate. So having tools that leverage the mobile ecosystem is what developers are looking for, and there have been lack of those so far in the market. And then lastly, high production costs. And honestly, I don't have a clear answer to that challenge. One important thing to keep in mind is that there are, again, many resources like incubators and accelerators that have connections with China manufacturing. So there is a lot of progress being made. But I think there is also expectation that because a certain mobile phone or a certain consumer electronics which has huge volume comes at a certain price, my IoT application has to fit in that price constraints. And the truth is, initially there won't be enough volume for that specific IoT application and there will be a premium that you have to plan for to pay. And so it's more about setting expectation and planning, but there is no real solution to it until you hit the volume, and then things become easier in terms of production cost. So at least for the first two challenges, you know, we have a certain response to those challenges. And the very first thing I'll start with is our developer network. So we have a Qualcomm developer network website where we host a multitude of software and hardware resources for you to leverage the mobile ecosystem and use the tools that you can easily go from development to commercialization. And one such program that I am part of at Qualcomm is the embedded computing program. So what we have done as a part of this embedded computing program is selected certain Snapdragon processors and added some key ingredients that are required for IoT devices and made it available through easily accessible channels like distributors. So, by the way, how many of you have heard about Snapdragon processors? Okay, good. So everybody is familiar with, exactly. Everybody is familiar with that. So we have selected few Snapdragon processors. So the two that are right now on our roadmap is Snapdragon 600 and Snapdragon 410. Snapdragon 410 is the processor that's in Moto G X. That was one of the very popular devices, very cost-effective device that was very successful. Even though I'm saying that there is a lot of leverage from mobile, there is still a lot of additional ingredients that are needed to make it ready for IoT. And one such ingredient is multiple OS support. So I'll talk a little more about that, but the chipsets that we pick for the embedded computing, we add more than just Android support. Typically, most of our Snapdragon processors only have Android support on them, but for this, we add more than Android support. We make extensive documentation available through Qualcomm Developer Network. And we make the software accessible. And this is our proprietary software that was only available to our licensees. Up until now, we have made that available for this chipset directly to developers like you to make the product and have the right software available for making the product. Another important requirement that we came across, and this is more applicable for industrial IoT, if you haven't come across this already, you will soon, is the longevity of parts. So, mobile roadmap cycle is 2 years, sometimes even less. But an IoT application sometimes takes 2 years to just design it. So you can't have a chipset that just goes out by the time you're ready to commercialize it. So we have added longevity to those chipsets. So those embedded computing parts will have 8 to 10 years of long life cycle. And we are working hard to make sure that the adjacent components that you need besides the Snapdragon processor also have that longevity. Another important thing is a Snapdragon technology provider. So we have built an ecosystem of partners called Snapdragon technology providers. They are the experts of providing design and integration services to new developers, especially on Snapdragon. So you can focus on your application and they will do what's needed to bring Snapdragon up to the level where you can just port your application on top of it. So they do all that hard work for you. And then finally, distribution. So that is another important thing. When I joined this group 5 years ago, because we had this Dragon Boards out there, it's not the same Dragon Board that I'm going to show you today, but the other Dragon Boards, they were bigger and more expensive, but they were still accessible to more people than what it used to be in the past. So they would come and say, oh, we love working on Dragon Board, now we want to go to commercialization. And the question would be, okay, what's your volume? And then they would say, you know, 10K, 100K. And we're like, oh, thank you very much, but we don't have a way to provide you that many choices. So that's the problem that we have resolved by making some of the modules based on Snapdragon available. And eventually, we are planning to put chipsets directly into distribution. So this, we are working with the world's largest, one of the world's largest distributor, Aero Electronics, to resolve this distribution issue.
Software and hardware. In terms of commercialization, what's the ability to use the software and the hardware platform to enhance open source? Is it commercially friendly open source? Is it reference design? Are you
Good question. So the reference design, the DragonBoard 4NC, is completely open source hardware. So you have schematics available under open source license, and you're free to use it. But currently, you don't get access to chipset directly. We are going to get there eventually. So you have to work with one of our technology partners, or Aero, and they provide you the needed software and hardware and on the commercial requirements. So, and friendly commercial stuff. So they probably charge them, but it's not what we are getting paid for is the chipset. That we are not charging the software or the platform to do it. You may have to pay something to this technology provider or a distributor to get access to it, but it's way lower than what you would pay if you have to work directly. Yes. And everything that's on QDN, Qualcomm Developer Network, those SDK tools, software, they all have the terms where once you develop on it, you're free to include it in your commercial product
as well. So, let's say, for example,
software for it. However, there is an open source And finally, when you are ready from going from development and prototyping stage to design and manufacture, you have option of buying off-the-shelf modules or do a custom module with one of our partners to meet that custom requirement that you have for IoT device. Because, you know, I can bet that your requirement will be different from anybody else's requirement because IoT devices come in various shapes and forms. So it's important to have that diverse offering, and that's what you get with the working with some of our partners. With that, I would like to introduce DragonBoard 410C, which is the tool that we have made available for IoT developers and give access to Snapdragon processor. It's a Snapdragon 410 based development board, so I'll start it with a video. And micro USB slot. There is 40 pin centers have 12 GPIOs and 2 I2Cs. And it has UART Spy USB on it too, and sorry, UART Spy and I2S on the low speed connector. And the high speed connectors have USB, MIPI DSI, and 2 MIPI CSI in addition to the 2 I2Cs. So, lot of expansion available on the board to connect many different peripherals to it. And there is an optional 16-bit audio expansion connector footprint, so if you want to add audio to your application, there is a way to do that. Coming back to commercialization part, so let's say once you use DragonBoard 4.10c and develop your IoT application, and if that's the form factor that's right for you, great, but what if it is not, which is going to be the case most of the time? You go to one of our partners. We have five partners right now who are working with us and providing the custom solution as well as multiple off-the-shelf songs based on different form factors. Aero, e-info chips, Enforce Computing, Intrinsic, Verisize. These are all well-known entities in the embedded IoT space, and there are many more partners that we are signing up because we are seeing a huge interest from these vendors to be part of this ecosystem. So there are modules, development kit, and single core computers available on the Snapdragon 410 platform. So that's the benefit. And finally, once you have done this development, what are the possibilities? What kind of applications can you develop using these Snapdragon processors? So we have some examples here, robotics, industrial and smart home applications, digital media, smart surveillance. I'm sure you have many more ideas that we haven't even thought about yet. So I welcome you to try developing on the board and come up with a new application.
Yeah.
Some of them. So for example, robotics, we work with Open Source Robotics Foundation and have the robotic operating system ROS ported on Snapdragon. So you can just use that. We already have it for Snapdragon 600. We are working with them to get it on Snapdragon 410 as well. Then for some of the smart camera and smart home applications, we are working with some partners to build some applications. So it's not there right now, but slowly it's coming up. And finally, if you are excited about starting your IoT application and using Snapdragon in your IoT application, the best thing to do is start at these URLs. So to buy the board, you can go on Aero's website. There is huge forum and forum community and software resources available on 96boards.org. Leonardo is managing that, and we have partnered with them to form a community behind this. And finally, you will find lots of documentation specific to Qualcomm Snapdragon processor and tutorial videos on developer.qualcomm.com. I think zero light shutter is part of our camera solution, but EIS is not. That is from the additional software.
So the question about it is all kinds of division of it, so on the network. So for the driving force.
For legal reasons, we can't put the cellular modem on the development board. You could use a USB modem to do your development, and then once you're ready for commercialization, there are ways to include it in your application, like the integrated chipset.
So what kind of barrier can improve?
The
price?
The price is
Yes.
This is we call the mid-tier. We don't have any plans yet for a lower tier, but
we still we have old Qualcomm. There are chips that are recruited strategy that are even lower tier. Maybe from our router space. We are MIPS processors. We integrated Lebanon and Fast.
Probably only by open source tools and stuff available for those.
Yeah. Yeah,
starting to develop a community involved in this platform.
Yeah. So I'm from the Snapdragon product management team. She's from the QCA product management team. So that's a different technology. But yeah, we do have tools around those. And on the Snapdragon, so we have Snapdragon 410. We have a higher tier Snapdragon 600. We already have some tools based on it, and we're also planning a DragonBoard based on Snapdragon 600. And next year, we are planning another chip on the roadmap, which is the higher 4K capable. Actually, what's my last name?
Gandhi.
Yeah. Gandhi. Gandhi got it first. Yeah.
Okay. Well, only people in the front get it, so.
Everyone's smart.
What, sorry, what?
No, so we have somebody in the back who isn't being headed for, so raise the hands first.
Oh, okay, so now my eyes are there. Okay, how many GPIOs on the low-speed connector?
Bravo.
So, as we're talking about the demos, we have sensors connected to the board.